I really would. You can say like seven times. I'm really sorry. Next time we'll get... Sure, you can come. We can train.
No,
we don't want to. Come on. Thank you so much for coming today to support Kelly Lynch in her GSD final project. Just a couple of ground rules. We will have a question session at the end of the presentation, so do please just save your questions to the end. Feel free to take notes throughout. We'll allow her to kind of guide that section, but just so you know, you can ask those questions at the end. The other thing is we do have presentations all day, so we're trying to move through them and keep on schedule as best as we can. So please feel free to engage with Kelly, but if you don't mind kind of moving into the foyer area, having some snacks, some coffee, and continuing the conversation there, that would be great. So I am just going to let Kelly introduce herself and her project, and so if you wouldn't mind putting your hands together for Kelly Lynch.
Hi guys, I'm Kelly Lynch, as she said, and my presentation is Free Tibet, Buddhism and Tibet's Relationship with China. So I'm going to be looking at the conflict between Tibet and China, which is pretty much China in 1950 annexed Tibet, and since then has been controlling the region, and there have been rampant human rights abuses and religious oppression in the area, which is what I'll be looking at predominantly through the lens of Buddhism and how the Dalai Lama and the Buddhist faith impacts this conflict. I was drawn to this topic taking Dr. G's India class last year, where we talked a lot about Buddhism and India and that whole part of the world. So when I was looking for a topic this spring, I was really drawn to Buddhism and looking at the difference between Tibetan and Chinese Buddhism, which brought me to this conflict. I would like to note that by looking at this topic and looking at Tibet as an independent actor from China, this presentation and I have an inherent bias because the Chinese perspective does not see Tibet as separate from China in any way. So by looking at Tibet as independent, that is a bias that I think is important to note. I think that it's interesting to look at this issue because there was a time when it was very, very well known and almost sort of a trendy topic to be looked at. I live in Manitou Springs, which is notoriously hippie, and so you see Free Tibet stickers and prayer flags everywhere. It's very, very trendy, so I thought it would be interesting to look at more of the academic side and the history and more of the facts. So that's what I'll be doing. My presentation is going to be in two parts. I'll look at the religious side, looking at the history of Buddhism. We'll do an overview of Buddhism, how Buddhism spread, a brief history of Tibetan Buddhism and Chinese Buddhism, and then we'll switch into the political side, where we'll look at religious repression in Tibet, the role of the Dalai Lama, the role of Tibetan refugees, and then some options for the future. So I'm going to start my presentation with a little clip of a video. So request that. Ooh. You might have a problem.
It's but okay. I have it on my desktop.
Okay, so this video is from the organization Free Tibet, which works to campaign to raise awareness for the situation in Tibet, and they released this video earlier this year, I believe, and it is an animation of the story of a Tibetan refugee. And when I was first watching this in my research, I was just so struck. It's a very powerful little animation, and I was just so struck by the story of Tibetan refugees even just today. So I wanted to share it with you because I think that it does a much better job of showing the severity and the real sadness of the situation better than I could say. So we're gonna look at the first half now, where we see a young Tibetan refugee fleeing Tibet and going to India to a Tibetan refugee center. And then later at the end of the presentation, we'll watch the rest of the video, which includes a series of flashbacks to her life in Tibet and her family and sort of her story there. So. in mind as we go forward in the presentation and some of the history and facts about the situation. We're going to go back and talk about the history of Buddhism, and then we'll finish this video at the end. Okay, so starting with the history of Buddhism. So Buddhism was founded in the 6th century by a man by the name of Siddhartha Gautama, who was later known as the Buddha. He was born to a wealthy Indian family. He was an Indian prince. And before he was born, his mother had a dream that a baby white elephant came and impregnated her with the Buddha. So that's a very sacred symbol in Indian mythology. So she sort of knew before he was born that he was going to be influential. And so he grew up incredibly wealthy as a prince, obviously very privileged. And then one day he went out and saw poverty, sickness, and death. So he saw someone that was begging in the street, someone that was very, very sick, and then a corpse who had died. And he was so struck by the plight of humankind and the great suffering of the human race and just how hard life can be that he left behind all of his wealth and went out into the world to seek enlightenment and to seek a path to help humanity pass this suffering. And so he tried various different methods of he tried yoga and fasting and various different ways to achieve enlightenment, but eventually by meditating under the Bodhi tree in Bodh Gaya, he was enlightened and was able to see, according to Buddhist mythology, was able to see all of his past lives. Because Buddhism does believe in rebirth or the cycle of samsara, the idea of reincarnation, so that's sort of what he looked back and was able to see all the lives he had lived and sort of the path to get out of this cycle or achieve nirvana or moksha, enlightenment. So through this, he found the Four Noble Truths, the first of which is all life is suffering, the second of which is suffering comes from attachment, the third is an end of attachment leads to an end of suffering, and the fourth is there is a path to end this suffering, which is the Eightfold Path or the Middle Way Path, which is what the Buddha and his disciples taught across India. So Buddhism spread very quickly across India. It was an incredibly popular religion because it is very accessible and it did not discriminate in any way. So it was very popular under the caste system, where a lot of Indian citizens were very oppressed in lower classes, and Buddhism offered them sort of a way out, a path where they themselves could be enlightened rather than waiting for their next lifetime in order to achieve enlightenment. However, it did not stay popular in India for very long. There isn't a lot of Buddhism in India today. So it traveled predominantly north along the Silk Roads, which I'll talk about later with China, which is how it got to China. But the single greatest actor for the spread of Buddhism was a man by the name of Ashoka, who was a Mauryan emperor. So his great-grandfather established the Mauryan Empire in India, and then he reconquered India for the Mauryan Empire, and after he had established that rule, he was so guilty and so struck by the horrible injustices he had done to the Indian people and all the pain he had caused that he converted to Buddhism and made it the official religion of the Mauryan Empire. So he did a lot to spread that. He encouraged a lot of missionaries and really cultivated a Buddhist tradition and Buddhist art. So his missionaries spread Buddhism to Sri Lanka and Myanmar and a lot of those southern areas. So around this time there was a schism in Buddhism between Theravada Buddhism, which is in the south, Sri Lanka and those areas, which is much more traditional and closer to what the Buddha taught, and Mahayana Buddhism, which is what is in the north, China, Tibet, and Nepal, those sorts of areas, which is more influenced by some other religions, so it's slightly more spiritual or mystical, you could say. It's more worship-based rather than just like meditation-based. So Chinese Buddhism, as I said, spread along the Silk Roads as Indian traders moved north, and then as the Han Empire expanded, more Chinese traders were exposed to these centers of Buddhism in the north, and it was brought back to China, where it also spread very quickly for similar reasons to in India. Under Confucianism, some people felt very held down by that very patriarchal tradition in Confucianism, and Buddhism offers a very individual approach to religion, so it was very popular due to that. However, it did have some difficulty in China because there were some words that could not be translated from the original Sanskrit Buddhist texts into Chinese, so they borrowed words from the pre-existing Taoist faith, which is more of like a nature religion, Zen faith, so it's very influenced by that in China. Throughout Chinese history under different empires, there were some times where Buddhism was persecuted or not supported as much, but overall it thrived up until the 1960s Cultural Revolution, when communism in China really came down very hard against Buddhism, because Buddhism and its individuality goes against a lot of communist ideals. However, modern liberal policies in China are leading to a bit of a renaissance in Buddhist thinking in China, which is interesting. So Tibetan Buddhism was introduced to the Tibetan kingdom in around the 7th century and has been the dominant religion in the area ever since. So Tibetan Buddhism is Mahayana Buddhism that has been strongly influenced by the Bon faith, which was the indigenous animal worship religion that was in Tibet prior to Buddhism. So because of that, and because Tibet is so isolated, Buddhism in Tibet developed differently than it did in a lot of other places. So there's some significant differences, like if you've heard of the Tibetan Book of the Dead, in a lot of Buddhism, when you die, your soul is immediately transferred to your next life based off of your karma and your actions within your life. However, in Tibetan Buddhism, there's a period similar to Christian purgatory, where your soul is drawn towards one of five realms of being in the wheel of existence based off of how you've lived your life, and then that'll be like, will you live in the human world, will you live in the world of ghosts, different things like that. And then probably most predominantly the practice of the Dalai Lama and the Panchen Lama as the spiritual leaders of Tibet, that is also unique to Tibet, that those leaders are chosen as reincarnations of past enlightened beings. So a brief history of Tibet. So Tibet, or the Tibet Autonomous Region, is in between India and China, so south of China, north of India. It is a small area in the Himalayas, often referred to as the roof of the world due to its high altitude. So for a brief history of Tibet, in the 7th century, it was unified into one central kingdom against China, and prior to that, it was not unified, just sort of... In 1244, it was conquered by Mongols, but remained fairly autonomous under the Mongol Empire, so it still continued to be pretty self-governing. In 1598, the first Dalai Lama was named. In 1624, the first European traders came into contact with Tibet, and those were Portuguese traders. And then in the mid-19th century, Tibet was forced to close its borders due to British and Russian colonial forces. And then in 1913, after pressure from both China and Britain for control of that land, the 13th Dalai Lama reestablished Tibetan independence, where it was independent in a closed kingdom until 1950, when the Chinese annexed Tibet. So at this point, Chinese troops came to Tibet to take control, exercising what they felt was a legitimate claim over the land, feeling that because at various different points in history, the Tibetan land had been a part of various Chinese empires, that was a part of what should be mainland China. So at this point, it was grouped into the Tibet Autonomous Region, and some of the outer provinces were just absorbed into parts of China and are no longer considered the Tibet Autonomous Region, and the rest was grouped together. This was met with violent protest, and thousands of Tibetans were killed in the struggle. And the young Dalai Lama, who was 23 at the time, he had to stay in Lhasa, which is the capital of Tibet, where he continued to be both the spiritual and the political leader of Tibet, until 1959, when a violent uprising against the Chinese government forced the Dalai Lama to flee to India, where he remains today in Dharamsala. So then after this happened, during the Chinese Cultural Revolution from 1966 to 1976, there was a period of extreme destruction in Tibet. Communist policy against Buddhism led to horrible treatment of the Tibetan people. During this time, 90% of Tibetan monasteries were destroyed, and the population of Tibetan monks decreased by 93%. So that's around 90% of the Buddhist culture in Tibet was brutally destroyed by the Chinese government at this point. So it was a horrible time for the Tibetan people, and very violent and very difficult, especially having just, their leader had just left, so they were
unled.
That's not a word. Wow. They were very, very lost, and it was a very, very dark and horrible time for Tibet. However, there has been resistance against Chinese control of Tibet, most significantly that violent uprising in 1959, and then again on the 37th anniversary of that uprising in 1987, there were riots beginning in Lhasa that spread throughout all of Tibet that led to the Chinese government declaring martial law. And then on the 49th anniversary, again, there was turmoil in 2008, especially surrounding the 2008 Beijing Olympics, sort of feeling that the world was giving these Olympics to Beijing, but there was no attention being paid to the human rights violations in Tibet. However, those were not very widespread or lingering protests. A lot of this is because Buddhism is such a peaceful religion, and the Dalai Lama encourages a middle way, peaceful method of protest with talks to the Chinese government and not a lot of uprising. So because Tibet is so spiritual and Buddhism is such a deeply personal religion, it's difficult for the Chinese government to discourage dissent, I guess, because the Tibetan people are so loyal to the Dalai Lama and so loyal to Buddhism that pressure from the Chinese government doesn't really break down that loyalty. However, recently, and sort of throughout the history, there's a big problem with protests through self-immolation, which is when monks will set themselves on fire to protest the Chinese government. And I think it's really shocking to me that this is still something that is happening today, and there are, like, even this year, there are quite a few monks that have done this, and it's really heartbreaking that there's still a situation in the world that causes people to feel that their last resort is to set themselves on fire on the street, and people are, like, this issue isn't getting a lot of attention anymore, and there isn't a lot of work being done to help the Tibetan people. And though this practice is discouraged by the Dalai Lama, it is still happening, and it is very, very heartbreaking. But despite the fact that very little progress has been made, there are organizations and countries that are trying to help Tibet. For example, India has done a lot for the Tibetan people, most predominantly welcoming refugees over their northern border that they share with Tibet. The most significant of which is the Dalai Lama, and the exiled government of Tibet lives in Dharamsala in northern India. And so they welcome the Dalai Lama, despite being in a time of turmoil themselves with the British, 1959, that time. However, the Indian government is hesitant to stand strongly against China because they are so close to them, and China is such a massive and dominant trade partner in the world today. It's difficult for India to stand very firmly and say, no, we do not support China, because China's so strong. It's a dangerous political stance to have. So the Dalai Lama, who lives in India, he's the 14th Dalai Lama. He was born on the 6th of July in 1935 to farmers in northeastern Tibet. He was recognized as the Dalai Lama when he was 2 years old and began training to be the leader of Tibet when he was 6. So the Dalai Lama is believed to be the reincarnation of a bodhisattva. So a bodhisattva, according to the Dalai Lama website, is a realized being who vowed to be reborn to help humanity. So it's basically someone who became enlightened at a point in history and then vowed to come back to the human world as a reincarnation to help people. So that's what the Dalai Lama is. So he has written multiple books and fights for the right of Tibetan people despite not being in Tibet. So he meets with the UN, he does a lot of work with Tibetan refugee communities worldwide because a lot of Tibetans have left Tibet. Like, for example, in Boulder there's a big community, so he comes to Denver fairly regularly through that. Alright, so looking back at human rights violations in Tibet, of course the most predominant and most violent time in Tibetan history was probably during the Cultural Revolution when there was all that destruction. However, today, despite religious revival overall in China, there's still concerns in Tibet that Tibetan Buddhism fosters anti-Chinese sentiment. So there's the Chinese government is not very supportive of Tibetan Buddhism. For example, recently this year, the Chinese government passed a law in certain provinces banning children from going to language lessons in monasteries. So traditionally, a lot of families would send their children to these monasteries to learn the traditional Bon language of Tibet, but the Chinese government banned that, sort of what is seen as a move to stop that tradition from being carried on in Tibet, which is interfering with the education system and stopping the progression of languages. Obviously a major step to stop a tradition and a culture from continuing into the next generation. But probably the most predominant issue in Tibet today with the Chinese religious repression is, I can't remember exactly what, but a while ago the Chinese government passed a law saying that China will have power over choosing the next Dalai Lama and the Panchen Lama, who the Panchen Lama is like second in command to the Dalai Lama, which, because it is a religious position, the Dalai Lama is chosen through a series of religious tests. It's not just anyone can be appointed the Dalai Lama. Like, you're chosen, you're identified as that reincarnation of the Dalai Lama. So the Chinese government taking over that power takes away the power of the Tibetan people to choose their leader. And this is likely going to become an issue very soon because the Dalai Lama is very old and not in the greatest of health. He's in and out of the hospital fairly regularly. I was going to see him speak my freshman year, but then he had to go to the Mayo Clinic because he was very sick. So when he dies, it will be a major issue, especially because the Panchen Lama, who is in second command, kind of like the vice president, and who plays a major role in choosing the next Dalai Lama, a new Panchen Lama was identified in 1995. He was a six-year-old boy, and immediately after being identified, he was kidnapped by the Chinese government, and he's not been seen since, so no one knows where the Panchen Lama is. So if the Dalai Lama dies and the Panchen Lama is not free, then it'll be a very tumultuous time for Tibet in that not having a spiritual leader for the first time since 1935. So that's going to be a major issue that I think the world will have to deal with at some point soon, because hopefully China won't be able to just ignore that, and the Tibetan people will be able to have a voice at that time. So it is important also to look at the It is important also to look at the Chinese perspective. So China obviously went into Tibet feeling that there was a legitimate reason that they could have control over Tibet. And so around this time with the rise of communism, there was a big stress on the idea of a Chinese national identity. And so the majority of the Chinese population is ethnically Han Chinese. So there's a huge sense of national identity in China. And so when communism was incorporating these outside territories, it's not just Tibet, there are a few others, they wanted to really make them a part of China rather than just like Chinese territories. So there were parts of Tibet that were just grouped into China. There were Chinese immigrants are very encouraged to go into Tibet, sort of trying to unify those two cultures. Because Marxist ideology really stresses having one national unity in order to move past an unjust system. So that movement into communism very much encouraged this idea. However, it makes it very difficult for talks about independence with China and Tibet, because the Chinese perspective is sort of that, well, Tibet is China, so there's no reason they should be, why would you want to be independent when you are a part of China? So it makes it a difficult conversation for the Tibetan people to say, we want our independence back, and the Chinese government to say, why? Because you're a part of China, you have no need to leave. So because of this, these Chinese motivations in Tibet, there have been severe consequences, as we've talked about already. There have been a lot of loss of that culture and Buddhist heritage, but also threats to the ecosystem in Tibet, because Tibet is in the high alpine Himalayas. It's a delicate and fairly unique ecosystem that has been destroyed by Chinese industry coming into Tibet. So predominantly recently, the Chinese government built a railroad from Beijing to Lhasa, which connects Lhasa to the rest of the world, which in some ways is positive, but there was also a lot of destruction of Buddhist heritage sites and the environment. And other industry in Tibet has also led to the Chinese government making plans to level whole villages and lose monasteries. So that was very dangerous. However, there has been a lot of criticism of the West and Western organizations like Free Tibet for almost wanting to keep Tibet as this like primal, pure place and not allowing it to industrialize and not wanting it to modernize. And I do think that's a valid criticism, as there are some people that do view Tibet as this primal place that needs to be saved rather than a nation that is capable of making its own decisions. But I do think that if China continues industrializing and modernizing Tibet, I think that it'll be incredibly important, or it would be ideal for the Chinese government to involve the Tibetan people in that process, like have Tibetans help make sure that monasteries aren't destroyed and that the ecosystem is being preserved in the right way. So I think that the ideal situation, if China continues to rule Tibet and to bring more modern industry into that region, to keep Tibetans involved in that conversation. Sadly, however, I don't think that that's what's happening right now, and I think that it's fairly realistic to say that that's not what's going to happen, but I think that that would be the best situation for Tibet other than independence. Alright, so at this point, is there someone wants to come back and help? With that background information, we're going to watch the second part of the video as we start to wrap up. So this part, you'll see the rest of our main characters. We'll see the rest of our main characters' story and her family, and just sort of finish up that visual of the Tibetan experience today.
Thank you.
So as that video said at the end, there are organizations such as Free Tibet who are working to advocate for the rights of Tibet and to raise awareness to this situation. However, it's difficult for them to achieve change. I think that the international community needs to put more pressure on this. And through the Dalai Lama, the UN has at various different points tried to help with the situation. They passed a resolution encouraging different countries to condemn the acts of China in Tibet. However, it didn't have any real consequences. It was more of a gesture. So the Chinese government was not really driven to change anything through that resolution, which is a commonly noted problem of the UN. So there are a lot of humanitarian groups, such as Free Tibet, that work a lot with refugees and mostly raising awareness and trying to keep this a prevalent issue. Like I said, there was a time when this was a very well-known topic. Everyone was talking about Tibet, but I feel that lately this has lost leverage in the international community. However, the situation has not really gotten any better. So I think from my research that in order for change to happen, because China is such a large and predominant country, that pressure from outside nations and the international community will be essential to change the situation. Right now the US has complex relationships with China, so especially relating to trade, China being such an economic powerhouse. And I think that in these situations, if countries like the US were to say, you have to stop your treatment of Tibet, and that doesn't necessarily look like independence. The Dalai Lama himself has said that like independence isn't the only option, it's just a matter of fighting for the religious rights of the Tibetan people, even if that is while staying under Chinese control. Obviously, that the ideal situation would be Tibet being an independent nation, but if that's not realistic, there's still many steps that can be taken to improve the situation from what it is today. And the Dalai Lama has said that even if Tibet became independent, the Dalai Lama would not be the political leader, which is interesting because the Chinese government definitely tries to portray it as though the Dalai Lama is trying to take control of Tibet. So this research really brought my attention to an issue that I knew very little about and that I did not realize was such a major problem in the world today. And I was just shocked in my research to see the violations and the tragedies occurring in Tibet that are not being discussed by the Western media, like the Chinese government banning language lessons. Why is that not an issue? Why are we not talking about that and that violation of free speech? So if you feel as moved by this as I am, there are lots of organizations you can check out. Free Tibet at freetibet.org, obviously. And then there are others, like Students for Free Tibet. There are lots of campaigns. If you just give it a quick Google, there are lots of things you can look into. So I really hope that I have helped you learn about something new and that you are as moved by this topic as I am. So thank you so much for coming. You guys, you two, what are you? My witnesses can ask questions. Thank you for that.
Why do you think that Buddhism left India to begin with, like when it first started there?
So I think that a lot of that has to do with Hinduism is a very welcoming, despite the casteism, is a very welcoming religion. So I think that like the Buddha as a god figure was just kind of absorbed into Hinduism, and people were like, oh, well, we're going to meditate and follow Buddhism. And a lot of Hindus were like, oh, well, that's fine, we do that too, you can just say it. So I think that it wasn't different enough from Hinduism to be long-lasting there.
Thank you, Kelly. You've done a good job.
Thanks.
Am I supposed to ask you?
Do you have questions?
You can if you'd like.
So I'm wondering, since World War II, the global community has agreed not to acknowledge, you know, wars of conquest where you grab land, and most recently the Golan Heights thing has been in the news, and Crimea and Russia, and I'm wondering if you've come across why China hasn't taken more heat for conquering Tibet. Or is this outside your research?
No, well, I mean, honestly, I'm not sure. Like, I think that's part of it, is why did this happen, and it was just sort of accepted. Like, obviously, there were protests, and the Dalai Lama did a lot to raise international awareness of this, but I think that, especially in China, around the rise of communism and the cultural, I think it was such a tumultuous time that, honestly, I think the annexation of Tibet just kind of happened, and once it was really noticed by the world, it was a little too late. Like, I think when it happened, there was so much other stuff happening in China and in the world in general that I don't want to say it wasn't noticed, but I don't think that it was a major issue. Like, if it happened today, everyone would be like, you cannot do that. But I think at that time, it was just a little lost. But I don't really know, honestly. I could do more research on that.
Well, that's an issue outside
right, yeah.
What you were doing, so.
And what do you think will happen if Dalai Lama dies? Is there any, in your research, did you come across anything of like the what ifs?
No, I didn't. I honestly don't know. I think it'll be very complicated because, so the Panchen Lama is sort of like the second in command, so I think that theoretically, like he was chosen in 1995, I think, to succeed the Dalai Lama and to be there when he died, but then also the Panchen Lama plays a major role in identifying the next Dalai Lama. So without him, I'm not really sure what they'll do. And I think honestly, because the Chinese government has such dislike for the Dalai Lama and for the power he has over the Tibetan people, I don't think that they'll do much to encourage replacing that figure. So I think we'll find out.
So you acknowledge that Buddhism is a highly sort of individualistic religion, and do you think that that focus on the individual affects Tibet's ability to sort of garner more protest and community from within in order to, fight back, I guess, from the inside?
Yeah, I think that it definitely has an impact, like, Tibet, just the Tibetan people, like, it's not the kind of place that's going to rally an army to, like, violently revolt against China, and it is much more, like, Buddhism, it's much more, like, reflective, like, okay, like, the Dalai Lama's not here, we'll just follow him from afar, and so I think that that definitely limits that, for sure. For better or for worse, I mean, it's much more peaceful, so that does have its benefits, but I think it is also limiting in terms of raising awareness for their cause.
In terms of this event, this pattern going on, reaching the media in a global scale, what do you think is the role of like press in the area, and how do you think maybe like different regulations and laws around freedom of press in China and Tibet might affect maybe our lack, like in a Western country, of knowledge around?
Yeah, so I mean, the Chinese government is notorious for censorship, so I don't think that, like, I think the majority of the news from Tibet is coming from either outside organizations that have people in Tibet or Tibetans who have left. I don't think there's a lot, like, the Chinese government isn't like, oh, here is our monthly statement on what we're doing in Tibet. So I think that there's a lot of information that is being lost because of that, and that is also difficult. And it's a pretty isolated place, like, up in the Himalayas, and there isn't a lot of, like, interaction with other parts of the world. I think that also impacts that.